time that we have together, for this amazing day, for your presence. I pray that we would delight your heart this morning, Lord, that our praises would be a sweet smelling fragrance before your throne, Lord. We've come here to worship you, for you to transform us so that we can become more like you and your son Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Morning, guys.
Good morning.
How's everybody?
Good day.
Good.
Woo!
Moment on, joy with heaven's
just want to draw your attention to the songs we're singing because we've chosen them for a reason. This next one is called God of This City. And I just want us to sing it believing, really believing the words that we're singing. That, you know, we're worshiping the God of this city, the God of this nation, and the God of this world. You know, and He's here, and He's moving, and He's amazing. So I just want to sing it knowing that and believing that wholeheartedly. You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless.
Yeah.
this song, it says, "Awaken my soul, come awake." And when you're singing this, I just ask that you pray this over your own soul, but also the souls of your family and your friends and the people around you. And that despite what's going on in the world right now, and even in your families or things you've never told anyone, and the struggle, that we're singing and we're declaring for your soul to come awake and see the living, loving God.
Amen.
Awaken my soul, come awake. To hunger, to see.
Let's shout hallelujah. 1, 2, 3.
Hallelujah.
Come, Belinda.
When I was asked to pray over the offering today, thinking about the crazy, difficult time we're in, I felt God say one simple thing: be still. This is repeated multiple times in the Bible. Be still and know that I am God is from Psalm 46:10. Be still and know I am God. I will be exalted above the nations. I will be exalted above the earth. And again in Exodus 14:14, the Lord will fight for you. You need only be still. Ecclesiastes refers to a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak. Psalm 37:7 says, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil desires. In the Message, it talks about quietening yourself before God. So I think now as we think about our finances, as we think about the challenges that we're facing, I believe God wants us just to be still, to contemplate who he is. Dear Father, thank you that as we contemplate giving our offering to you, we know that you are God, you are in control over everything, that we can trust you completely. So I'd just like to play a song as you come up to give your offering.
That last night. Please be still. Jokes. Thank you, Lord, for the promise of peace. So, this song we chose because it's about the cross of Christ, the crimson river, like a flood, and that Jesus found us and saved us. Nothing really happens without the reality of the cross of Christ in our lives. So join with us and sing.
On yonder hill, the darkness flew. Announcements are the men pray on Monday night at 7 o'clock here at church. The ladies are still on Zoom at 10 o'clock on Tuesday morning. And then the most exciting news, we are starting Alpha on Tuesday night. So that is going to be an amazing time. We sang this morning that greater things are yet to come. Greater things are still to be done. So please, invite your friends to come. We are going to look at just the questions of life as we go through the course of Alpha. We're going to have a meal together. Everything's going to be done according to plan, according to the rules. It's going to be an amazing time. So We are very excited. We are anticipating salvation. We are anticipating God moving. So please, if you want to hear the foundations of Christianity, what it's about, please come. Tuesday night is a welcoming dinner, and then we are going to start the course the following Tuesday. So we're very excited. We have felt for a long time, a few months, I think 5 months, that God wants us to start Alpha. It's a time for salvation. In the natural, when we are restricted, we have felt that God has wide open spaces, which is salvation. So that is happening on Tuesday. It's very exciting. Okay, we're going to pray for the for Yaku. Father, we do thank you that for your word that is like apples of silver and settings of gold, that brings life and transforms us. We thank you for your goodness, for your faithfulness, and that we can come here this morning just to worship you. But thank you for your anointing on Yaku to speak a word in season. Your word never returns void, but accomplishes everything that you have purposed. And so we thank you for that. Amen.
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 Go.
Hey, you guys. I know you all are singing. I just can't hear you like when we're inside, you know. So, but I can see some of your mouths are moving. Sean singing the loudest, of course, as always, from the back there. Louder? You sure? Can you guys hear me over there, Lynn? So nice to see Linda again. Don't go near her. She's tender, but send lots of kisses and love. Also nice to see Jan and Tina. Hey, guys. Lovely. Coming all the way out from Burlington. And some visitors, if you're visiting with us today, we just want to make you feel so welcome. Kick off your shoes, chill out in the grass. It's lovely, isn't it? So, we are in Genesis chapter 43. I'm going to do 43, 44, and 45 today. Are you ready?
Yes.
Turn with me in your Bibles. Yeah, Lord, I thank you that Kath's already prayed. Thank you that your presence is everywhere because you're omnipresent. I do believe, Lord, there's a space in our lives that if we open our hearts to you and our minds to you, that you come in and you're intimate with us and you have dinner with us and you fellowship with us. And so, Lord, with all that intention right now, I ask that you would come and meet every one of us as we hear your word, as we submit our lives to your word, as we turn our hearts towards what you're saying. Lord, my whole life I've desired to be pure before you so that I could receive revelation from you, from your word, lest we stick into a place where we just read scripture as a formula or a rule of life. And it's so much more, it's rooted in relationship with you. So I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would reveal these beautiful chapters of the story of the patriarchs, the fathers of our faith, as we call them. As you reveal what you're doing and what you're saying through these stories that seem so sometimes childlike as we read them to our kids and tell them with great passion, that we would see your great narrative, your great plan, your purpose to restore all things back to you. You are amazing, God. You are awesome. If we look at the sun and all its glory and its radiance, if we look at the nature where we are, you've created all things. And through you, all things exist. And nothing exists without you. And so for us just to be here together in this place, Lord, there is no preacher that can do what you've already done. There is no sound system. There is no ambience that we create that can do what you've already done for us. And so with all of that in mind, we quiet our souls and say, Holy Spirit, reveal yourself to us greater and greater measure so that we could live more and more into the fullness of your plan. And if you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, guys, chapter 43. So, a quick recap. Joseph. Joseph was sold by his brothers and thrown into a pit, an empty pit, the Bible says. There he was. Slave traders came by, they pulled him out and sold him for 20 shekels of silver. And off he went, ended up in Potiphar's house as a servant, was falsely accused by Potiphar's wife because she couldn't have her way with him, ended up in prison, interpreted dreams in prison because God gave him this ability to interpret dreams and to reveal himself to him, and then was forgotten, and then were remembered, and poignantly at the right time, God brought him out of prison, obscurity, and out of this hidden place that we sometimes work so hard not to get into. God brought him out of that, and instantly from a place of prison, he became the prime minister of a country where he ruled over Egypt very powerfully, and he interpreted Pharaoh's dream, basically of the seven fat cows, seven thin cows, seven fat sheaves of wheat and thin ones. The thin ones ate the fat ones, which meant that there were 7 years of fatness going to be first, and then after that's going to be followed by 7 years of famine. All caught up. Amen? Somebody's got to say something, or wave, or shout, or whistle. Say yes, I hear you. Come on, I need it. All right. And so it's exciting. Here we are, the life of Joseph in chapter 43. So his brothers arrive because the 7 years of abundance is over, and they are 2 years into the famine. The food runs out all over the earth, and from Canaan, where his family's from, the brothers, 11 brothers, are now coming, and Joseph presents them with three tests, basically. And today we're going to look at the third and final test that Joseph presents to his brothers. And also as he processes his own life and his own journey on how he has dealt with forgiveness, rejection, misunderstanding, and false accusation. These things all in God's sovereign plan. When his father Jacob said in the conclusion of 42 or 41, said, "Why is God doing this to me?" And when they found their money in the sacks, they said, "Why is God doing this to us?" They see the unfolding of God's glorious plan, as we're going to see today in these next three chapters. Because even if you think that God is against you, he's not against you. Because Romans says that God takes everything and uses everything for his good and works it out for our best interest, for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And that's you and me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to lead a lot of amens or hee-haws or whatever you like. Okay, so Judah persuades Jacob to take Benjamin back. So Joseph said to them, "Okay, guys, you can go back, but Simeon stays behind." Judah steps in. Judah, remember, was the guy who sold Joseph into this. He was the actual one who threw Joseph into the pit. Reuben, the older brother, said, "Guys, we're not killing, no bloodshed." And Reuben says, "Right," he goes into the pit for now. And actually, a couple of chapters back, they sat and had lunch very close to the pit where Joseph was screaming his head off to get out. So they were quite indifferent to his story at that stage of the game. Now he's sold. It's years later, and Reuben is silent, but Judah convinces Jacob. So all the brothers went back home without Simeon. He was in jail in Joseph's prison. Everybody with me?
Yes.
They go back. Jacob is absolutely heartbroken. "Why have you done this to me? You guys are horrible. God is against me. I'm just a very sad old man." And Judah steps in and says, "Please, let us take Benjamin back. I guarantee you that we will get Simeon back and bring him back safely. And we'll fill up our bags with grain as well while we're there. And please trust me and make some serious vows and promises to him." So to get back to Egypt, Joseph had prepared a feast for the brothers, which is so weird. Because remember in the previous chapter, halfway on the way home, Levi opened his bag and the money that they paid for the wheat was in the bag. And when they got home, they found out that all of their bags that they'd filled with the grain from Egypt were also had their money in their bags. So can you imagine arriving back home? Joseph is now the second IC of the greatest empire on the earth at that stage, and also the hope of the nations because it had food. And he invites them not only into a kind of a central space, he invites them into their home, into his house, into his palace, and prepares a feast for them. And so the brothers arrive, and they were so petrified, they were shaking and trembling, so much so that one of the brothers went to the head servant and said, "Listen, We know what's going on here. I'm taking a bit of license here. Maybe he said this. We know what's going on. This is a trap. He wants to bring us in here to slaughter us all. We didn't take the money. We didn't know that the money were in our bags of the grain. We don't know how that happened. We're so sorry about that. Please don't let us be slaughtered here in Joseph's house today. And the head servant said these words. He said, I don't know what you're talking about. All of you on my record have paid for the grain that you've taken. And then he says these words. It's in the Bible. He says, maybe your God did this for you. These are the brothers who always keep saying, oh, God is against us. What is God doing to us? You see, God's getting us back for what we did to Joseph as their hearts of guilt is revealed. The head servant of the Egyptians says to them, maybe your God did this to you. And so they were stunned and puzzled and confused, and they entered into the feast. They sat separately. Joseph sat by himself. The brothers sat by themselves in order of their birth and age. And the Egyptians sat by themselves, because the Egyptians would never sit with Jews, ever, in history. And so, when Joseph sees Benjamin, now Joseph and Benjamin were like this, they were the two baby brothers, and they loved each other dearly. And when Joseph was sold into slavery, it must have devastated him like it did his father. And when Joseph saw Benjamin for the first time in many, many years, he couldn't keep it together. And he ran out. And he cried. And he had to wash his face and do his makeup again and make an appearance again. And so they were seated. An interesting thing about this feast in chapter 43 is that everybody got the same meal. Must have been an amazing meal from the king's table. But Benjamin got five times as much. Say that with me. Benjamin got five times as much. Julia, say it.
Benjamin got five times.
And that is the end of 43. 44. Joseph tests his brothers for the third and final time by planting his silver goblet in Benjamin's bag. They have the feast. They fill up their sacks. The head servant said to them, your debts are paid. We don't know about the money in your bags. That's cool. It must be your God blessing you. And they went back. The whole family, super stoked, off they went. And as they went, Joseph says to his servants, guys, get after these guys and find them. Fetch them. Stop them. And as they did, they find Joseph's goblet, or it had another name, the cup of divination of Joseph, was found in whose bag, do you think?
Benjamin.
In Benjamin's bag, his favorite son's bag. And Jacob's favorite son's bag, and devastation breaks out. Five times as much. So Joseph is loading Benjamin with favor, seemingly unnecessary in the eyes of his brothers, to see if the brothers had truly dealt with their jealousy towards those who are favored. Because remember, he was favored when he had the ornamental coat. The coat of many colors. And it was their jealousy of his favor that caused them to sell him out to slavery. And he wanted to see if they had dealt with this reality. And so he set the scene by putting Benjamin five times as much to see if they would do that. So they brought him back, all of them back, and stood in front of Joseph. And for the third time, they bowed low before Joseph. Do you remember what Joseph said to them? Do you remember what his brother said to him many years ago when he told him the dream? Joseph, are you saying that we are going to be bowing down to you one day? And this is the third time that these brothers are bowing low before him. He was quite eager to see their response. Would they sell him out like they sold him out? Like they sold me out? And nothing reveals our hearts like the false accusation sometimes. And these are all areas of our lives where we are dealing with social issues that ultimately, friends, I promise you, prepare us to reign. Someone listening to me, yes. Say amen, please.
Amen.
All of us are prepared to reign, because that's God's mandate for us, to rule and to reign and to have dominion over the earth and to be a part, a vital, alive, crucial part of the reconciliation of all things back to God. We are His hands and feet and mouth and words and lives. We are those that God has chosen. Okay? It's not like we're this exclusive bunch, but we are the remnant. We are those, the life. We are the salt. We are the light in the dark that live lives Even so much so that the pagans, like they have and have done forever and ever, would look at our lives and praise our God. Ascribe this glory to our God. Because God will use everything in our lives to prepare us to reign and to rule. And if we are not ruling and reigning in the small areas of our lives, we will never rule and reign over the bigger areas of our lives. God never entrusts us to be faithful with our dreams. But He always entrusts us. He always demands that we are faithful with what we have right here and right now. Someone say yes. Amen. Okay. Amen. It's so wonderful, this glorious gospel. And so Joseph wanted to see what they did. And he had to know that they had truly changed. He had to know that his brothers had, in fact, repented. And they were now thinking differently. You've got to see it in the bigger narrative of what God is busy doing here and ruling and reigning through Joseph, his son. And so they bowed low before him because their minds were new. Their lives were changed. And Judah again stood up and said, as the mediator, he said, "We are all your servants. None of us will leave this place." Joseph said, "No, no, 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 no. I'm the king here. I say what's happening. You all leave. The guy who had the cup, he knew full well it was Benjamin, is the one who's staying as my slave," because he wanted to make sure that they're thinking differently. Would they say, "Okay, okay, all right. Benjamin, sorry, dude. You had the cup in your bag. You know, it might have been you. We're not going to die for your sake. We're definitely not going to be slaves in Egypt for your sake." No, everything had changed. They bowed low before him. Matthew chapter 3 verse 8 says, "Produce fruit in keeping with repentance." It means that if we think differently, there's a manifestation of it. Does that make sense? Our lives do not remain the same if we think differently. And a lot of psychologists throughout the years have picked up on this and read many books about this. But the rethinking is the actual word repent. It means we now think differently. We used to think in this way, and because we thought in this way, it produced something in our lives. Brokenness, dysfunction, no margin, no fruit. The fruit was exhaustion, sickness, apostasy. Our hearts were hard. We were calloused. We were indifferent. We were narcissistic. We were numb. We felt nothing. And the fruits are there in multiple ways. And if we think differently, if we pivot, if we turn towards God, which is everyone, every human being on this planet's divine design, is to pivot towards God, the first thing that's affected is our thought process. What you think about. You got to think what you're thinking about. And so Joseph were looking at these brothers and saw that they were thinking differently. "Produce fruit in keeping with repentance," Matthew 3:8. "And do not think that you can say to yourself, 'We have Abraham as our father.'" These brothers were standing there because of a lineage. Please hear this. They were the people of God, chosen by God. And they were standing there, and Joseph did not want them to come to a place of codependence to a system. Even though it was Egypt and they had what they needed, he wanted them to turn towards God, knowing that God is the only one that can truly transform and change their lives. And that's what he was doing. No, don't become codependent on me and my mercies and my handouts. Know who you are, know whose you are, and then you will flourish and function. And then you will rule and reign. And then you will have dominion. And then you will have control over your own desires, because you have a greater cause to live for. Amen. Woo! Quiet down, guys. Quiet down. It's okay. Next point. "So I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." Wow, sobering. Just stop and think for a second. If you're one of those brothers, I know it's thousands of years ago in a completely different culture. Starving families at home. Starving. I don't know if you've ever seen starving people. Never mind being starving. Desperate. Hopeless. And Joseph wanted them to think differently. Nothing has changed to this day. The voice of the Holy Spirit always The Holy Spirit was sent to be our paracletos, our helper, the one who carries our load, and the one to convict us of our sin. Sin means simple. Don't talk dirty language. Sin just means you're missing the point. It's not hellfire and brimstone. It just means you're missing the point. Why? Because you're thinking in a certain way. And so rethinking allows you to see the purposes of God, which is the point. And when that happens, when we rethink, it's so easy. I loved Steve last week. Did you guys enjoy him?
Yeah.
An amazing guy. Through the Psalms, start there, read it. You'll see the heart of God revealed to you. So that the fruit of our lives could be fruit of righteousness. Righteousness means we did nothing in our own strength. We just turned towards God and allowed His Spirit to do the work within us. And Joseph was keen. He was not going to let his brothers become these codependent guys who never took responsibility for their sin. That is the most pathetic thing to do, to live your whole life and never say no to yourself and never take responsibility for your sin, for missing the point. Oh, I've missed the point. I've got to think differently. So he persevered. Joseph, like his brothers, had to be transformed to be able to carry the purposes of God. And us, like Joseph and like his brothers, have to be a part or engaged in the process of transformation, which only happens through the Spirit of Christ. And God uses every single circumstance you find yourself in to give you the option to pivot towards Him. If you don't pivot towards Him, you will pivot away from Him. It will produce fruit. Either fruit of righteousness or fruit of unrighteousness. Unrighteousness, it says clearly in the Bible, leads to death. Righteousness leads to life. And right in the beginning, these same tribe people, God said, I put before you today life, death. Here they are. They're before you. Choose life, choose death. If there are two cages behind us right here, one has a chicken in it, and the other one has a bear, a grizzly bear in it. And God says to you guys, go into these cages, choose one. But I'm just telling you, God speaking, I'm just telling you, don't take the grizzly. He's going to maul you and kill you. Do you believe me that there will still people be here, right here today, who will choose the grizzly bear and be mauled by it? And this is Joseph's persistence with his brother. You know why? Because Joseph had gone through a massive process, and now that he was ruling and reigning, he realized, probably fully for the first time, the purpose of God for his life. He basically had three robes. The robe of favor, you know, the ornamental one. It was ripped off for him by his brothers because of jealousy. Favor ripped off because of jealousy. The second one was the stolen robe, was ripped off by Potiphar's wife because of false accusation. The third one was the robe where he was forgotten. And finally, God lifted him up and gave him the robe to rule and to reign. Has that ever happened to you? Can I be as super practical as this? Say to you, if you want to rule and reign, are you willing for the robes that you're wearing to be ripped off you? Your own independence. What you call common sense, according to a worldview that's shaped by narcissism and the world that we live in right now. Can you see the kingdom? Are we living for something that's much greater than ourselves? In that regard, are you willing for the robes to be ripped off you? Are you willing to be falsely accused and to be silent? Are you willing to be forgotten? In which God said to David, I'm hiding you in the pavilion of my love, safe from the strife of tongues. I'm hiding you in the shadow of my wing. You are hidden. Are you willing to do that so that you could reign one day? Are you? What robe are you wearing? Is it one that God needs to take off? Judah sold Joseph for 20 shekels of silver. Joseph's goblet weighed 20 shekels of silver. Judah has now become the mediator between Joseph and Jacob, his father. And from the tribe of Judah came the Messiah, the anointed one, the only one who can break the chains of bondage, the anointed one, the Messiah, from the tribe of Judah. What can we say? Judah says to Joseph. What can we say? How can we plead? How can we prove our innocence? We are guilty. We are all staying. Benjamin is not staying. It's all of us or none of us. What is that? To me, that's the proof that there's been transformation in their lives. That is the fruit of righteousness. It's beautiful. Chapter 45. The secret's out. So Joseph can no longer hold it out and shouts for everyone to leave the room. Get out, everybody! Get out! Shouts for all his servants, and he cries and he sobs and he breaks down in front of his brothers. The Bible says he cried so loud that the house of Pharaoh heard that he was crying. Can you imagine the sweet reconciliation between him and his brothers? I am Joseph, he says. Can you imagine their faces? The beauty of that reconciliation. Many scholars believe that this is a metaphorical, prophetic picture of the reconciliation of the Jewish people when they see and recognize the Messiah, according to Ephesians 4 and Romans 8. The promise that they will come back, their eyes will be open, and they will see the better Joseph in front of their eyes, Jesus the Messiah. Doesn't that make you feel so privileged? Makes me feel privileged that God saved us and revealed himself to us through his son Jesus. So he cried so loud that Pharaoh's house heard. And I want to read from 45, just a couple of verses. Then Joseph said to his brothers, come close to me. When they had come close to him, he said, I am your brother Joseph, the one that you sold into Egypt. And now, do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there's been famine in the land. For the next 5 years, there will be no plowing or reaping. Verse 7. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Church, I believe that God wants to send us ahead of the world. Not in a way that we are better than anyone. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about living for a different reality. Someone say, yes, I understand that. Please. Say something. A different reality, that we're living as if the kingdom is here now. It is a sober responsibility that God wants to place upon our lives. In the Gospels, it is repeated so many times by Jesus that we are not to be like the world, that we have to be like our Father in heaven. And that's why we have to hear the voice of our Father in heaven. And that's why you cannot become codependent on any other voice that drowns out the voice of your Father in heaven. And the voice of the world that we live in is so loud that I want to encourage you, saints, friends, brothers, sisters, hear, listen, wait for the voice of your Father. And hear that voice, because he will reveal something greater. God's plan for us is not to settle. God's plan for us is not to be just the norm or just to be just like everybody else. He wants us to be ahead, to show the world what is to come. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? What a responsibility on us. It provokes emotion in me to the extent that I can't compare it to anything. It provokes in me a desire to worship him, to fall on my knees, to cry out, Lord, who is like you? You're amazing. Why would you choose us? Why would you give your life for us? These three pleas, what can we do? What can we say? How can we defend ourselves? We're guilty. We're guilty. So then it was not just you who sent me here, but God. He made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of this entire household and the ruler of all Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and say to him, this is what your son Joseph says. God has made me lord of Egypt. Come down to me and don't delay. Remember when the brothers asked him, will you bow before us? This is the moment. Three times he tells them, don't feel bad, don't condemn yourself, don't feel bad. This was God, so that we could go before. so that we could know. Who would ever have known a famine would have come and the remnant would have been destroyed? The purpose of God would have been thwarted. But circumstantially, through your lives, when you threw me in the pit, you set me up for the divine purposes of God to be fulfilled in my life. And some of you are in a pit of despair. You can't get out. There's no one to help you. And those around you don't want you to come out of that pit. And God says, I am with you in the pit. And I will not leave you in that pit. And even if you're sold into slavery, I'm going with you. And even if you misunderstood, I will not leave you. And even if you're rejected and forgotten, my purposes are still prevailing and finding its fulfillment in your life. Trust me. When the butler left, 2 years later, he remembered Joseph, because Pharaoh had a dream. And suddenly, he was standing in front of him. Remember the words? Remember what he said. Pharaoh said, Joseph, I heard that you are a guy who can interpret dreams. He says, no, you've heard wrong, your majesty. I can't, but God can. And I am in covenant with that God. And you are in covenant with that God. 3 times, he said. 3 times. I love this 3 times thing. 3 times. 3 nights Jonah was in the belly of the whale. 3 times a day Daniel knelt to pray. Solomon's temple had three windows, pairs of threes. And on, Job's had 3 daughters. 3 days Jesus was in the grave, and then he was alive. And on. Jesus said to the Pharisees, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it again. What a glorious Savior. Hosea speaks of this threefold blessing of God, the grain, the new wine, and the oil. On the 3rd day, Esther stood before the king and was able to intercede on behalf of the nation Israel. You and I believe in a triune God, 3 in 1, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And all of this was part of God's plan. Let me just go back to Genesis 12 and read to you what God promised Abraham. The Lord said to Abraham, go from your country, your people, and your father's household, and to the land that I will show you. And when I was reading this, I was praying, and I wanted to say to everybody that's come to Canada, okay? And this works vice versa to every nation of the world that you go to. Because you felt the unction of the Spirit of God for you to go. I want to say to you, well done. Thank you. Thank you. Well done. Who am I to say thank you to you, but well done. I want to cheer you on in the faith for responding to the stirring of God to go. Like the Abrahamic promise. And when God brought you to this country and blessed you in this country, remember this, the second half of the Abrahamic promise. Through the church, the nations of the earth are blessed. You are the church, so he blesses us to be a blessing. Think that through in your life. Process that through in your life. And even your ancestors and your father and your father's father that came from other countries. It's a movement of divine orchestration throughout the nations of the earth as God is moving. In Acts chapter 17, from every nation, tribe, and tongue, God brought us here to this place. Even in this small gathering, the nationalities from all over the world. It's the big narrative. It's God's Abrahamic promise that Joseph here, generations later, generations literally now, sees. And it's crucial that we see God's great plan for Canada, for Milton, for our cities that surround us. He is the God of the city. He is the Lord of the nation. He is the one that brings hope and life, like we sang. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Woo. So it says, I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. And whoever curses you will be cursed. And all people on the earth will be blessed through you. It's like a name for it. It's like a poem. Like every second line lines up. I don't know what it's called, but it's this. I will make you into a great nation. I'll make your name great. I will bless you, and you will be a blessing. And this particular line, I absolutely believe to this day. I've always believed it since I turned to Jesus. Since Jesus saved me, I will bless those who bless you. I still believe it to this day. Anybody who blesses the body of Christ, you included, will be blessed by God himself. It's a part of the Abrahamic covenant. And that reason for that blessing is so that we could be the manifestation of the riches of God to the nations all around us. And then there was a lot of crying and kissing. They all cried, they all kissed, and they hugged. You can just imagine. I love to live into those moments, you know? You just be in that moment, in that room, where they were kissing and hugging. They can't believe it. Joseph, is this you? Kiss, kiss, kiss. Is this really you? Whoa, your beard has grown. Look how tough you are. Oh, you know, whatever, you know? Lots of kissing. And he says they will live in Goshen. Goshen means to draw near, to become close. Isn't that beautiful? And so Joseph's palace was near Goshen. It was in the Western Nile Delta, super fertile, beautiful ground. And Pharaoh hears about Joseph's crying, and he's so moved by it. He asks his servants, "What's happening?" And they say, "Joseph's brothers have come from Canaan," and he recognized them, and they reconciled his family. And Pharaoh says, "That is awesome. Tell Joseph that I say, bring them all and let them all come and live with us." And you might think, wow, what a cool story of deliverance. Exactly. That's the God we serve. He redeems everything. If you think nothing is redeemable, you're wrong. He can redeem it. He can save you. He can take the garbage and transform it into new life. There's nothing he cannot do. Isn't he amazing? The glory of God. Jacob trembled when his brothers told him. The Bible said he shook. He couldn't believe that Jacob was alive. He almost had a heart attack. "My son is still alive," he shouted. And for the first time in 22 years, God again speaks to Jacob. And in his fear and brokenness from losing his son, God restores Joseph back to him in his old age. Guys, come on. This is amazing.
Very good.
And he sobs. And God speaks to him and says, "Jacob, I love you. I am with you. Don't be afraid. This is all true. Go down to Egypt. I will preserve the remnant." I love that word remnant. It's the coolest word in Scripture. It's not an exclusive word. It doesn't put us on a pedestal. It just means that God handpicks people from across the nations to carry the thread of his story from generation to generation until the fullness of who he is revealed. And you and me, we are a part of that remnant because God picked us by hand. Yes, come on. Sandy Queenan. Powerful. I believe it. Amen. That's the end. Jacob goes down, massive reconciliation. And next week we will finish off the book of Genesis. Super exciting. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand together. I want to pray. So obviously, I love it when we take the Word of God and we can apply it in our lives, right? So I want to ask you a question. If you're wearing a robe and you're feeling discouraged and disillusioned, I mean, obviously we're in a time of COVID-19 where we're isolated and that touch and that affection and that drawing close is a difficult thing as the body on a broader scale. It can cause you to become discouraged, right? Right?
Yeah.
Right? Anybody? Anybody just a glimmer of discouragement? Sometimes. And so this is again our Father, good Father's invitation to us to come to him and to experience his embrace, his hug. And so if it's you, as we pray, literally just allow the Lord to hold you, to strengthen you, to reaffirm you, and also to rip the robe off you that you're wearing, that is keeping you in a place. If that makes sense. So Father, we ask you to do with us as you please. God, come and fill us with your purpose and presence. Thank you for your great narrative. Your beautiful story of redemption for mankind. that you wish that none should perish, but everyone come to know you as you reveal yourself to us by your Spirit. None of this will ever be caught through osmosis or information. This is a relational reality. It will never change. As it is in heaven, let it be here. Lord, in heaven there's no disease. In heaven there is no walls of unforgiveness. In heaven there are no roots of rejection and alienation. In heaven there are no preconceived ideas about race, gender, color. In heaven there is complete unity, not a harmony that is brought in from the outside, but unity because your Spirit is there. In heaven you are a king. You are King of Kings. There is none above you. There's no one like you. You are enthroned on the praises of your people. In heaven there are no tears of sorrow. And then you say to your disciples, your closest friends, this is how you pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So Lord, we pray that you would, your kingdom comes through us. Your kingdom finds expression through us in the world out there. Help us to rule and reign with you like Joseph. From the pit to the prison to the palace. Help us to rule and reign. Because our lives are no longer our own, they belong to you. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Guys, I'm sorry I was so long, okay? It's very hot in here. You guys alive?
Yeah.
All right. Praise God. Thank you. Goodbye.
Oh.
Stay as long as you want on the field. If you go inside, you need to wear a mask.